and they spend money on Facebook. They spend money on ads, and that's the outer periphery of trust, where a referral-generated buyer is about 7 times more likely to buy, stay, buy more often, refer more people, and cost nothing. We have 125 different ways to generate referrals. 125. You're never going to do 125. You're never going to do 25. But if you did 3 and you have none, that could explode your business or your business for somebody else. So that's one approach. Know what complementary products, services your market buys, just to ask them, ask your clients, what else, what is you buying? Who are you buying it from? And then find out who those companies' competitors are.
Exactly. So the three action steps here are: look at broker sites, because I know you're gonna look at broker sites and see what kinds of businesses are for sale that might fit your categories and kind of what they're asking and that sort of stuff. Remember, 80% of them don't sell. Then take an inventory of your off-market sources using some of the things that I just mentioned and your own brainstorming, and then use the acquisition wheel that I gave you to help find things as well. When you're trying to figure out who to talk to, the best thing is to talk to an owner. The easiest way to find the owner of a business is just to call and ask who it is. But a couple of other ways, Zoom Info provides that as well. I'm not an affiliate or have anything to do with them, by the way. It's just one of many sources. Data Axle would be another. I think Info USA is another one that will provide that information. Check the webpage where they've got About Us or Team or contact information. That's a good way to do it as well. If you're in the United States, there's a company called there's a site called secstates.com that lists all of the addresses for the secretaries of states for every state. You can use Whois and do reverse lookup, or you can go on LinkedIn and search there, and you'll typically find founder or owner of a business. So lots of ways to find the people to talk to. Once you do, you want to connect with them. So use your own personalized voice to do this. Don't come up with a prefab package thing that makes you sound awkward. You know, like, hi, my name is Bob, and I am calling about your business. You don't want to do that. That's not going to connect you with them, okay? Ask them. Sincerely, ask them, say, you know, hey, I want to find out about the business. Tell me the story of the business. Tell me the story of your entrepreneurial journey. We know people love to talk about themselves, right? People love to talk about themselves. Let them. And when they're doing that, they're going to give you all this valuable information, right? As they do, if you find common touch points, like you're from that state, you always wanted to go to that school, you've always been interested in whatever thing they said they were interested in, then let them know. That will help build know-like trust, right? And then future pace them by asking them, what would it be like if you sold that asset or that business, okay? That's what you do. That'll help you connect with them. Then you're going to want to gather data. Now, data is easy. Rather than asking for financial statements and tax returns and things that make walls go up and attorneys get called and accountants get called, there's only a few things that you need. Screenshot this data sheet. I'm also going to make it available to Tony's team, so it'll be in the portal for you. This is all you really need to know. The whole left side is just asset information, and the right side is liabilities, asking price, that kind of stuff. So this is all you need to know. The two questions that are in the bottom right corner, though, are very, very important. The two questions in the bottom right corner are, what is the seller's reason for leaving? Ask them that. Ideally, it's one of the 10 things that makes them a motivated seller that I gave you earlier. Okay, what's their reason for leaving, and what do they want? What do they want, and can you help them get that by selling the business? Maybe they want more time with the kids. Maybe they want to travel the world, but if you're helping them sell the business and that gets them that, that's great. The next thing is to say, is what they're asking reasonable? There are lots of third-party resources. You can always just Google, what is the multiple for a plumbing business? What is the multiple for a digital marketing agency? What is the multiple for whatever kind of business you want in Google? We'll give you the result. Equidam and the NYU Stern School of Business publish lists of values. There's a company called BVR, Business Valuation Resources, that has a paid service as well. But I will give these to the Tony team as well so that you'll have an idea what lots and lots of different multiples for different categories of business are. And then last but not least, with about 2 minutes to go, I can give you how to fund your deals with zero out of pocket. And the goal here is to use creative financing so that you have the businesses literally pay for themselves. And we've identified over 220 strategies, just like Jay has 90. Yeah. I mean, we have so many things. I think between us, we've got like 10,000 different things. So someday we'll do like a five-year seminar and just kind of get it all out.
I would like that.
But the deal stack is what I like to call this. And this is because you're trying to go from zero out of pocket, which is what you want to pay, to whatever the seller wants for their business. We're trying not to negotiate with them. We're trying to collaborate with them. Collaborate to get them what they want. Negotiation to me is there's a winner, there's a loser. Collaboration, we're working together towards the same goal. My goal is to get every seller what they want for the business if it's reasonable, okay? So the deal stack does this. We just basically stack up all the different strategies like little Lego blocks to be able to get them the money they want. Briefly, here are some of those strategies. The first is carve out. So if they have assets in the business that you don't need or want, carve them out and reduce the purchase price correspondingly. Let's say they've got a big machine that you don't need or want, and it's a t-shirt printing machine, and it's a business that does lots of printing, but you don't really care about t-shirts, and it's a $100,000 machine. You can take $100,000 off the purchase price and say, I don't need that. I want the other assets. You can carve out almost anything. Ask the seller to finance the purchase. I almost start every offer with an ask for an 80% seller finance at zero interest over 10 years. And you'd be amazed how many times I get it, okay? You gotta ask to get it. Earnout is a similar thing to seller financing, except it says, hey, there's some portion of the business, maybe 20%, that I'm not sure if once you sell it to me, if it's gonna perform at the same level or not. So how about if we create a benchmark and say, as long as the business hits this in sales, then I'll pay you that other 20%. And if it doesn't, I won't. It gives the seller a chance to get paid more for the business, and it reduces your risk. So it's better than seller financing because you might not have to pay it. Seller financing, we have to pay, right? And again, we're not going to pay it personally. We're going to do this through our SPV, the company we set up to do the acquisition. So the earnout would be the next way. And my opening offer is typically 80% seller financing and 20% earnout, and then I'll work back from there. So inventory consignment. If you're buying a business that has an inventory, just take all of the inventory and leave it in the seller's name and tell them you'll pay it as you sell. Tell them you'll pay them for that inventory as you sell it. You can also go to suppliers and get loans. And if you're thinking no supplier would ever get a loan, I can tell you about one business we had that was a home rehabbing business, and we were thinking about going in, opening a store to compete with Home Depot. Stupid idea, but you know, we have them. And it was gonna be called Rehabber's Warehouse. And Home Depot actually came to us and offered us $2 million cash up front, not to go into that business, to keep buying from them for 2 years, and another $2 million at the end of the 2 years if we...
True story.
Yeah, $4 million from a supplier, no strings attached other than shop with them like we already were. You can factor accounts receivable, so the business has people that owe it money. You can simply factor those accounts receivable and sell them to somebody else. You can go to services like Leiter or American Express, and they will look at the revenue that the business has, and they will finance the business with a loan based on the revenue that it's been earning. So that's a really, really good way to go. Asset-based lending is another way. If there's any assets the business has that can be collateralized and you can borrow against, machinery, cars, that kind of stuff, you can do that. I always go to the integrators, the people who are operating the business. If the seller is leaving the business, and they don't always leave, if they're leaving the business, then who's going to take over and run it? Back to where all you guys said we need people. So I want to have an operator for every business that I acquire. So I'll go and talk to the employees who are the managers and the key people, the COO, the CEO, the CFO, and see if they would be willing to invest in the company. And I'll typically sell them about 20% of the company, 10 to 20. And then last but not least is... a private placement. So you can go out to third parties and raise money, which I don't like to do that very often because then you're beholden to people. Go ahead.
And just a couple points. So the reason that we are collaborating on the book and then we're actually doing a lot of acquisition deals ourselves is that Roland understands all that, and he's also a very good marketer, but relationships, hobbies, and then you'd be this little tiny area on business skill sets. Most of the businesses out there aren't good marketers. They aren't good selling. They don't know the three ways. They don't know any of the 97 ways. And all of those mean almost instant revenue increase when you do it for no other investment. And what we used to do, and I've done a lot of this, I would help somebody who wanted to buy a business look at the predictable lifetime value and the yield in an asset. An asset is a buyer. An asset is a distribution channel. An asset is a salesperson. And go to hard asset lenders who would be love to get 12 or 15% and say, we'll give you 30% on the money because we were making 300.
Exactly. So what I've got here for you to look at is like a $2 million deal stack. So let's say that you were looking to acquire a company for $2 million or 2 million pounds or wherever you are in the world, right, 2 million euro. And we just stack these things on top of each other. So maybe I use a private placement to raise 100K, and then I do 50K by offering it to the existing management team. Maybe I get another 100K through financing some of the assets they've got. Then I'll get a revenue-based financing loan for 100K. Again, all in the name of the company. I'll factor accounts receivable and get 100K. I'll get a supplier loan for 100K. Then I'll do inventory consignment. Let the seller keep 150K of inventory and pay them as it sells. I'll do an earnout for 300K, get 600K in seller financing, and carve out another 400,000, right? It's the flexibility that you get by having all of these tools that helps you be able to do as many deals as you want without ever having to come out of pocket. A couple of quick examples, $125,000 Facebook group, somebody was offering for sale for our real estate business, 53,000 member Facebook group. They were asking 125K. We agreed on a 75K purchase price, which, by the way, would be way higher than we would normally do. We just knew we could monetize it really fast. The seller agreed to receive the first funds that we got from any kind of cash flow. So they basically, it was a revenue-based financing through the seller. So the seller got paid when we sold something. We immediately went out and sold a sponsorship to a mortgage brokerage that didn't compete with us to have exclusive access and create content for the Facebook group. We had a one-year sponsorship for a training company. Sponsorships are frequently overlooked because sponsorships are better than investors. Sponsors pay every year. Investors pay once and then they own part of you. Sponsors pay every year and they own nothing.
And just to finish the case, I'm sorry, please.
And then the last two parts were we split equity with the finder, the person that found the business for us, wanted to come in the deal. So we let them come in for $2,500 and we did a credit card advance for the others. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say the point he's making is that company didn't know how to monetize the assets, the relationships they had. That's all.
That's awesome. Okay. Another one, SaaS company, software as a service, $300,000 asking price. We agreed on a $100,000 purchase. We did that over 9 months at $10,000 a month with a seller finance thing. We also call that owner carry. And then we had them do a short-term 30-day note on the down payment for the first 10K. We sent one email to our list, and I think we generated about 30K. So that was really cool. And then this one to me is the really fun stuff. So this was a publisher. They're asking $3.9 million. It's a $1.3 million EBITDA company. We were able to agree on 1.5 times profits or EBITDA, so that's $2 million purchase price. Got an 80% loan from my neighbor who lived two blocks down from me that said, I was always saying, you know, hey, I just can't get enough return on my money. I was like, how about if you loan me some money and I will, I'm jumping ahead. The seller financed a 80% through the balloon. Then I got a short-term note from them for 30 days. For my neighbor, I got a private loan for $400,000, 3 years, 10% interest only, okay? Paying zero interest to seller, paying 10% to my neighbor. Wanted to get rid of that as fast as possible, so I went and found two people. My private banker was one. I had a banker that was always like, how do I get in on a deal with you? I was like, I've got one for you. And I had an accountant, and the accountant was always like, how do I get in on a deal with you? And I was like, I've got one for you. So I sold them at a 3X valuation for 800K, and they've seen this, so nobody gets mad or anything about this increase in valuation. If you buy at a low, low, low price, and you sell to other people at market, they're going to be happy. Just be able to disclose that to them. So effectively now, I've paid off my neighbor, right? Paid back that, gave him an extra 40K to say thank you, 1 year's interest, and ended up owning 80% of the company, put $360,000 in my pocket. That's what's possible when you think creatively. So then you just want to close the deal. The last part, which I'm going to go super fast through, is cashing out and selling. Think about selling every 3 to 5 years. If you were to hold your business and it was to earn, let's say it's earning 500K and it increases 7% per year. At the end of 16 years, you would have received $13.9 million in income during that time, and you would sell it for 7 times, in our assumption, what its EBITDA was or its profits at the end of that time. Means you'd put a total of $23.6 million in your pocket over that period of time. If instead, every 3 to 5 years, you were to sell, you were to pay taxes in the United States, it's about 21% for corporate tax, so I'm just going to say 21%, and you used 50% to finance a new acquisition, you would at the end of 16 years end up with over $70 million. So the difference in selling is that you're getting paid maybe a decade, maybe a couple of decades of profits all in 1 year. If you do that a few times, you can easily, over a 20-year period, be 100 years of income ahead of anybody else. And if you think about that, $74 million versus 23.6, I mean, it's better. It's 3.14 times better, right? And every 50 million or so helps. Jay and I both have always.
Yeah, yeah. Said. And I love the metaphor of rinse and repeat.
Yes. Yeah. That's it. Remember that there are trillions of dollars sitting on the sideline in private equity and companies to buy companies like yours. And our goal is to buy the companies that are smaller. We call them blue box and green box companies. Those are companies that typically sell for between 2.5 and 4 times their profits. And then we want to sell those and grow them using all the cool things that Jay does and that Tony teaches to private equity companies who typically pay 15.2 times or public companies where the current rate is about 24 times. So think about becoming this aquapreneur where you're acquiring or partnering, build, build, and sell, and you can create a lifetime of income.
And the only thing I would say, it doesn't matter where you start. You don't have to be huge to do this. It's got scalability. It's got smaller applicability. It is so much faster, safer, easier, and much higher yielding just on the acquisition. But when you overlay all the mechanisms and think the three ways and the advance are only 2 of 97 different ways you can blow up EBITDA. And when you blow up EBITDA, that turns into 5 times, 10 times, 20. It's just so wonderful.
So if we have time for questions, the team here will tell us. We will do that. Just to kind of remind you of what you learned, we talked about the three advanced ways to do this. We talked about 2 strategies to achieve the three ways. Super fast, super shortcut, no risk. That's partnerships and acquisitions. And then we talked about how you can get that lifetime through an exit of wealth and income every 3 to 5 years.
Yay. Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, Roland Frasier, Jay Abraham, give him a hand. Let him hear you. Great job. I know. It was fascinating, Tom. Let him hear you. Send some love in the chat box. Send some love in the chat box. My friends, good. If that was spectacular for you, make some noise, my friends. Spectacular. Look at the feedback. I agree with Holly Ford from T9. She's like, it was too short. It was too short. So, gentlemen, they both agree. Talk about, I mean, there's so many things to talk about right now, but let's use their time. Q&A. You got some questions? Raise your hand. Ask intelligent questions. Roland and Frasier, Roland and Jay, kind of agreed to answer some questions. So you either put it in the chat box or you can raise your hand. We've got one here. It is from Team 2. And it is Angela. Give Angela a big hand. Hi, Angela. Where are you from?
I'm from Tennessee. It's so great to be here, and thank you all so much. This has already been an incredible morning. I don't even know how we're going to top this. I'm just so excited.
That's awesome. You're doing great. What's your question?
Yes, my question is, as an artist and business owner and still in the operator side as well, what about attorney fees, legal fees? Because when you start adding up all those, I kind of count like the number of contracts and the paperwork. And I know you said don't get in the tyranny of how, but I'm just curious how you manage legal fees, because I would imagine you guys have a way to leverage that or, you know, tips with those fees that can add up and eat into profits.
Absolutely. So there's a few ways to do that. One is that in most deals, the attorneys get paid after the deal closes. So if you're moving towards closing on a deal, we typically pay the fees from the company that we acquired. You can negotiate that the company that you are acquiring will pay the attorney's fees in advance. That's another thing that you can do. The other thing that you can do is you can partner with the attorneys and say, hey, I'm going to be doing a few of these. Would you be willing to do the work? And I'll give you 3% or 4% or 5% of the deal. There's a lot of ways to do that. So you can also say, hey, how about we do it as a success fee? And once the thing closes, then we'll do it that way. Or would you be willing to finance your fees mm-hmm. over some period of time so that I can get paid, so that I can pay you from the company? So lots and lots of ways to do that. The other thing is to really, really save yourself a lot of fees. If you do this right, and I want to be careful, so no legal advice here, but think about the possibility when you're using an SPV and you have no money out of pocket, you really have no financial risk. So I'll frequently close deals with no due diligence, no attorneys, using templates from attorneys that I have already done a ton of deals with, right? And then I'll do the due diligence after the deal closes because I don't care if it doesn't work out. I have no risk, right? And once it does work out, then I know that I'm willing to pay the fees and spend the money to do that due diligence. Does that help?
It does. Thank you so much. That was very insightful.
Great job. Thank you, Angela. Great job. Great question. Who's up? Who's up next? We got team three. Is it Heron?
Hey.
How you doing, man? Where are you from? Where are you right now?
Hi, I'm Rehan. I'm from Perth, Australia. What an honor to be chosen. Thank you.
We love it. Thank you, man. What's your question, Rehan?
My question is, in really mastering that second area you talked about in acquisitions, what are the top five common mistakes in executing this strategy you've shared with us, and how do you recommend to solve them?
Great question.
That's kind of a multi-part question because you got five things, but really the first one is being clear on what you want with your acquisition criteria. People just go and start acquiring kind of like a kid in a candy store. It's like, I don't need any money to acquire. I can acquire a dog walking service and a hotel and a digital marketing agency. And none of those things have anything to do with a coherent, cohesive, intentional plan accomplish something. So what's my acquisition criteria? And the second part of that is, what is my plan? Why am I doing this? The next one would be that you get caught in the heat of the deal and you pay too much, so that you're not willing to wait for a truly motivated seller who has a reason to sell and solve a problem they've got. We're not looking to take advantage of anybody. We're looking to help them out of the challenge that they've got. And so if you go to somebody that says, well, I never thought about selling, but if somebody wants to pay me stupid money for it, I will. And then because that's the deal that you've got, you just stick with that deal and you don't do anything else, which leads to number four, which is that you don't have enough deal flow. You need to really think about when you're wanting to acquire, it's so easy to get lists of the potential acquisition targets that you want that you should have a couple hundred, right, that you're working at any given time. So not working enough of those so that just the one deal that I've got has to go through. And the last one, is not being able to walk away. So a lot of these are cakes that need to bake. The seller needs to be more motivated than they are the first time you talk to them. And if you can walk away and say, look, it's really not a fit for me right now, but I'd love to stay in touch with you. And if it seems like you're going to be in a better place to sell a little bit later on the terms that I was talking about, then I'd love to have a conversation with you. That builds pipeline. So those would be the five things I would say.
I love that. I can't add.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Frank. Good job, man. Great job. Good job for being awake in press time right now.
Yeah, staying up.
Let's go ahead to Team 9 and give it up for Lindsay. Lindsay out there from Team 9. It is. Hello, 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 hello. Who have we got here?
So, this is my husband, Brian. Almost husband.
Brian.
My question is, and maybe this is one that Jay can answer, but once you acquire the business, and once you start the process of integrating into it, what are some of the challenges with optimizing? The challenges that come with actually bringing a staff to optimizing their sales or optimizing their marketing once you've acquired.
Great question. So I look at what I'll call the entire revenue system optimization. I look at everything they're doing, how it's doing, and how to make the existing activities better. Most people, depending on how they sell, first of all, pardon my voice, they don't target their audience properly. They don't make the best offers. They don't convert the best. They don't monetize the best. And I look at every facet because normally there's as many as literally 30 or 40 impact points, and you're not going to go on all of them, but I'll give you just a few. You can check. We've tested, because I've done all this, we've tested different ways of interfacing. If you're walking into a retail store, we've had large ones where we tested 33 ways of impacting or presenting ourselves at the front door and found one that was 300% better. We've changed a headline or its equivalent. A headline, you know what that is. The equivalent is a subject line. The equivalent is the first thing you say. The equivalent is what you see when you hit the website if it's e-commerce. The equivalent is what you basically do in your email, and quadrupled result. We have added a better risk reversal, which is taking away the risk of buying, and got as much as 50% better. We have added bonuses and gotten like as much as 300%. I didn't go on and on, but there's just a myriad of them. Does that give you an idea?
How do you handle the management or the getting the team on once that's happening?
I don't understand the question.
So if you're purchasing a business and you're keeping the staff in place, how do you get, like, how do you go into them and actually, as a leader, get them to buy into the systems while you're putting them in place?
I don't think Tony has explained to you yet my strategy of preemminence, has he?
No. I have not yet, Jay.
Yeah. So, okay. So I am known worldwide for having created the strategy of preeminence. And you have to understand that there's two different kinds of business owners. There's a true entrepreneur who's adding value both external and internal. And then there's a proprietor who's just basically sucking economic oxygen out of the air. If you're really a true entrepreneur and a value creator, you're not just doing it for the outside market. You have three kinds of clients. Okay, so strategy of preeminence, real quickly, I got to rush through this. You want to be seen as the most trusted advisor, and it's all about leadership. It's all about basically wanting more for your market, but you have three kinds of clients, certainly the ones that pay you, but the other two are the ones you pay. Instead of trying to squeeze everything out of your team or your employees, you want to develop and grow everything within them, because most businesses get a fraction of the yield. I have so many different mechanisms. One is called greatness, and most people aren't great. Most employees aren't great, but half of them aren't great because they don't know how to be great, and nobody's ever taught them. I can go on and on, but I hope that gives you just an insight.
And tactically, you typically have a post-integration plan that you put into place. So you say, in advance, when you're acquiring a company, one of the stages of due diligence, you'll have management interviews. And so you'll interview all of the key people and you'll say, hey, listen, we're looking at coming in and we're so excited to come in because you're super valuable. We love what the company is. That's why we're interested in the first place. Here's our plan. And we want you to buy into that plan. We want you to be part of that. And that's also why one of the cool things about integrator equity is having those people have the opportunity that they never thought they would have to invest in the company and own a piece of it, while at the same time providing you some of the capital to finance it. So that helps a lot as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, true great companies are able to have a corporate culture.
Businesses. And so I'm looking at this as like, how do we create partnerships and how do we create strategic alliances? And then how do we also get those people to buy into the vision of what we're creating? And so I'm shifting into entrepreneur from artist.
And I ask, because your question was an operator question, does that make sense? If you think about what Tony's done the last 12, 13, 14, 15 years, where he's gone from, you know, 8 or 9 core companies where he was an operator to now he's got over 110, 11, 12, 13 companies. He's doing exactly what Roland and Jamie are talking about. He's coming in as an owner with guiding principles and systems and processes. He's not looking to be hands-on. And what Jay just said, he didn't use the same language as Tony, but that's what Tony's ESOP is about. If you've been to BM1, you know Tony talks to Tony ESOP'd his company. Everybody here, it's a key part of RRI. We're all bought in. Like, we're bought in. Does that make sense? So when your team, when your internal customers, as Jay said, are bought into the company, I don't need Tony to be here to do a great job because we're in the mission. Does that make sense? So you shift to that owner mentality and then you've got systems and processes. You're looking just to come in and do your leadership and your culture and your vision, not, you know, make coffee and paint the fence. It's not your job.
Love that. That's a really great distinction. Thank you.
Cool. Good. Give me a hand. Good job. Well done, guys. Let's do another one. You guys are doing awesome. These are good questions. We got team 5. We have Kate. Hello, Kate McKay. How are you? I know. Hey, Kate, whereabouts are you?
I'm in Toronto.
Fantastic. She's in Toronto, Canada. Very nice.
So my question, I guess, is a bit specific. I'm in a property management business, and during your presentation, I started thinking the best complementary business for us right now anyway would be a landscaping company to help with all the properties that we manage. And I have someone in mind, but they are very heavy operators. So there's just 2 of them, very, very small company. They're my neighbors. And I think I can add a lot of value to them by pulling them out of the being operators, by cutting their costs, being their client, and so on and so forth. But I guess my question is, I wouldn't want to buy them 100% out because I have zero interest in being a landscaping operator. How would a partnership of some sort work in that sort of situation?
So I'm going to answer from an acquisition standpoint. I'll let Jay answer from a partnership standpoint. From an acquisition standpoint, we have lots and lots. And I mean, you're in a great position as a property manager for handy person services and, you know, lawn care and screen repair and cleaning and all kinds of other things that you could say, look, my business is a lead gen business for all of these other businesses. So I'm interested in acquiring them. What you do is you go to those 2 guys and you say, listen, you know, love you, mean it. I love what you do. I can send you a ton of business, and the challenge is I'm not really into building other people's brands for them that I don't have an interest in. So what I'm willing to do is if you'll give me X percent of your company, you can pick the X, then I will make you my exclusive referral source, and I'll help you grow so much faster. And then it's win-win because you're getting a piece of the business that you're increasing the value of. Worst thing that can ever happen, and Jay will tell you some stories about this, is that you help build somebody else's brand, and then your brand suffers some terrible consequence, and the other brand that you help build becomes this huge company. So what we do is we just go to them and say, you know, for us to have that relationship and give you all that benefit, we want to have some equity as well.
Yeah, I'm going to give a 2-part answer as quickly as I can. I'm sorry we don't have more time. And you stimulated a thought I really forgot. So let me go back for a minute to that thought. almost half of the businesses out there, and probably this is relevant to all of you, get some significant part of your revenue from referrals or word of mouth. Raise your hand if you do. Referrals, raise your hand. So this is going to shock you. I used to do this with Tony when we had live audiences. I'd have everybody stand. Stand if you get at least 20 or more percent of your business from referrals or word of mouth. Just stand. Please, I want to make a very powerful, okay, and remain standing only if you have in place at least one formalized, systematized referral generating strategy that you follow all the time. If you do, stay standing. If you don't, sit down. Two, stay standing if you have two, sit down if you don't. Three, stand if you keep. And most of the time when you get to three, they're dead. And yet the same people that get most of their business from referral don't even understand. They spend money on Facebook. They spend money on ads. And that's the outer periphery of trust, where a referral generated buyer is about seven times more likely to buy more often, refer more people, and cost nothing. We have 125 different ways to generate referrals. 125. You're never going to do 125. You're never going to do 25. But if you did three and you have none, that could explode your business or your business for somebody else. So that's one approach. The other, and Roland and I were talking the other time, and I'm racing the clock, is people don't understand. There's a correlation. We used to get home improvement companies, and a landscaper is one, but we would show people that when somebody does one thing, so example, you remodel your kitchen. Your house looks great in the kitchen. It looks like crap everywhere else. So what do you do next? You do your bathrooms. What do you do next? Maybe you do your carpet. What do you do next? Maybe you do your landscape. What do you do next? Maybe the roof. What do you do next? Maybe the garage. What do you do next? I told Roland, we just spent $150,000 fixing our driveway. You can connect all of those and put yourself in what I'll call the toll position. It's a lot more expansive, and I don't want to waste our limited time, but does that help?
Yes, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Great job. You guys are doing awesome. We're going to squeeze one more in, so I'm going to make one person their lucky day. We got time for one more. Let's go to teammate. And it says Maxine, but I don't think it's Maxine.
Yes, it's Maxine.
Hey, who we got here?
Maxime, yes, it's me.
It's Maxine. We're about to
cool name with an M.
Yes, thank you guys. And my first language is French, so thank you for your understanding. And I'm really grateful. I want to say, like, I feel like just watching what I just watched, I feel like it's better than winning the lottery. I just want to name it.
Very nice.
My question is, I have this belief I'm observing. I feel like I need to have a better financial strength, or that my financials needs to be in a better place to even start doing that. I need to pay my debts. I need to have more savings in order to feel more secure before acquiring more businesses or starting acquiring businesses. So my question would be, can you challenge that, or if it's actually better to pay my debts first?
Pour le premier, votre anglais c'est parfait. Oui.
Okay, that was classy. That was very classy, Roland. Well done. Well done.
So, do you want to start?
No. Okay. I want you to start.
One of the biggest mistakes that I see in life is that we get ready to get ready to get ready to do something. And so we can't do this. We set all these artificial limitations on ourselves that this chain of events must occur before I can whatever the next step is. So you can do this. There's nothing that Jay or I shared with you today or that you'll learn in this whole program that you can't start doing immediately. And so my challenge to you is that you have false beliefs that are holding you back around the list of things that you must do to now take action and do the next thing. So it's kind of a built-in procrastination and holdback system that you've got, that if you can break through that by just looking at everything that we said, it doesn't matter if you're in debt currently, doesn't matter if you've got all kinds of business challenges, financial challenges. If you're in bankruptcy, I've had people buy businesses that were about to go to jail. I've had people buy businesses that were in bankruptcy currently. I'd had people that were at the bottom of, I had a guy that sent me a DM and said, I had a gun in my mouth. I was ready to end my life because I didn't see any way to go. All of those people turned their lives and their businesses around and are successful now using these strategies. You're probably not anywhere close to the place that those people were. You can absolutely do this. You tell yourself you can do it. You make the list, you set the goals, and you put time on it that you're going to do it by.
Yeah.
You will make this happen.
And one more thing, and this is not meant to tease you. It's just meant to tell you we're out of time. You didn't even talk about consulting for equity.
Didn't have time.
But why don't you give them a 1 minute?
Okay, sure. So one thing that you do have for sure is you have knowledge, skills, experience, and connections, or you have the ability to get those things.
Yes.
It costs you nothing. It can be found instantly because so many people sell their time for pennies on the dollar of what it's actually worth.
Yep.
That you can take that skills, training, knowledge, experience, connections, and go to companies that you would like to be involved with and offer them those things in exchange for equity in those companies. It's both of our favorite way to acquire, more than just like buying a business, is to go in and say, hey, look, you could use help with this. And so that is something that you could start tomorrow. And let's say that somebody says, well, I need help building funnels. And you're like, I don't know how to build funnels. There's a whole list of people at ClickFunnels that know how to build funnels. There's a whole bunch of people at Upwork and on Fiverr, right, that will do them for almost nothing. So if you go into a company and say, I'll do all your funnels for you, 10% of the profits.
Yeah, and it's arbitrage.
It's arbitrage. And let's say it's making $1 million a year right now. Well, now you got $100,000 a year and you're going to pay somebody 10 grand top to do the funnels. You get a 10x return on your investment, which by the way is infinite because you're not paying any money. And you can do that right now. There's no reason you can't there's no reason you can't do it right now. One super quick thing is if you calculate the average number of days that a person lives, that a male or a female lives, and you are male or female or identify that way at the time, and you say, I don't know, like the average person, I forget what it is now, but let's just say it's 70, and you subtract your age from 70, and then you multiply that number by 360, that's all the time you have left. If you cross that number off every day, those days are ticking away. And so every minute that you spend stopped, frozen, not taking action, in fear of what's next, you're squandering that precious resource of the life you have left. Don't squander it. You can absolutely do this.
Yeah, it's great.
I feel like we just walked into David Destiny. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know what just happened for you, but for me, that was one of the most elegant, professional, impactful, spectacular presentations we've literally ever seen. Ladies and gentlemen, can you please get on your feet? Honestly, truly, send some love in the chat boxes to Roland Frasier and Jay Abraham.